And thank you to Cindy and to Max and to Josh for all the introductions that you've made today. It's lovely to be here with you and to follow, talking about impressive footsteps to follow yours also, Josh, just then. And thank you also to Anne and to her colleagues at the National Trust for the invitation to be here as well. When Anne and I had a chat a few months back about tonight's event, I think, as Josh mentioned, this year is the 75th anniversary of Curtin's assumption of the role as Prime Minister, and I think Anne was very keen that we could do a conversation about what it meant for Curtin, what it meant for us, I guess, for Curtin to be Prime Minister, and possibly even a conversation about World War II itself. Many of you would know my own specialisation is not so much 1942 as it is 1916, hence the name of the slide tonight. And what I'd like to do instead is talk with you about what Curtin's First World War experience meant to his experience as Prime Minister in the Second World War. There are many connections between the two, and some of those are transparently evident. And they're to be acknowledged, absolutely. But the other thing I want to talk to you about today is how Curtin's experience of the First World War not only shaped our understanding of his second, but also shapes our understanding of modern politics, security, social and political issues of modern Australia. These aren't new ideas. Some of you have heard me talk about these sort of things before. What I'd like to do tonight is to talk about his Second World War, talk about principally his first, and look for connections that we can make, particularly from that First World War experience to modern Australia today. Now, in July 1942, we'll start there. Despite me saying that we're talking mostly about the other things, we'll start with the Second World War. So we start in July 1942. Australia was then entering what could be described as the crucible, its crucible of the Second World War, certainly its darkest months in any event. Now, 6 months earlier, the British naval base at Singapore was defeated. By this time, air raids were now being waged across Australia's skies, and cities like Darwin and Broome had been attacked and in some cases nearly destroyed. Our civilian population there, therefore, for the first time, was suffering losses of their own. Cities like ours, cities like Fremantle, prepared for what they believed would be inevitable invasion. 9 and 6 inch guns were positioned on top of Arthur Head, at Buckland Hill, at Rottnest, Garden Island. Steel nets were strung between the coastline, between the coast here and Garden Island, as well as across the mouth of the river, all of which were meant to deter Japanese submarines. And if any of you are maritime archaeologists or just pretty good divers, apparently you can look for those nets at the end of the war. Instead of being removed, the ropes were just cut and they've dropped to the ground. So apparently, if you're a decent diver, which I am not, you may be able to find the evidence still. Ammunitions. Did you realise ammunitions in Fremantle were stored in the whaling tunnel underneath the roundhouse? They were there principally as a storage facility. They would be accessible if they were needed to defend Fremantle. But they were also conveniently positioned as a booby trap. If Japanese sailors or soldiers climbed the beach at Bathers Beach, climbed the sands at Bathers Beach, the Australians could implode the ammunition store, it was thought, in the whaling tunnel as a means of, I guess, preventing any further advancement on at least some of them. Now, in July 1942, the war was dark elsewhere too. This was a really dark phase of the Second World War in its history. In that month, we saw the beginning of the systematic deportation of Jews from the Warsaw Ghetto. In the same month, we saw the opening of the extermination camp Treblinka in Poland. In France, in that month, the Vichy government, the so-called free government, certainly the collaborators in the south, rounded up 13,000 civilian men and women, children, French Jews. French Jews had been deported by the Vichy government since at least March, but in July, for the first time, they had a mass arrest program that that swept across the south of France. 13,000, as I said, were arrested, were sent first of all to a winter velodrome before they were then deported to Auschwitz. In northern Africa, in July, the first battle for El Alamein began and was waged as Rommel began his assault on the British forces there. And in New Guinea, the Japanese army crossed the Owen Stanley mountain range to take Kokoda. This was a dark period in the world's history, in the World War. In Australia, where Britain had been defeated nearby in our region, we were left by this time utterly dependent on our alliance with the United States. And yet even this relationship wasn't without its own strain. There had, for instance, been a rather embarrassing moment a little earlier that year when the American fleet arrived in Sydney, most notably, the salvation of the country, it was seen to be, and yet coloured African-American Marines on board the ships were prohibited from landing in Sydney because of the White Australia policy that was still in place. And so Curtin, as Prime Minister, had to assemble a hasty meeting of his cabinet to introduce temporary changes to the immigration policy to at least enable the coloured troops, who were here to save us after all, of course, to land on Australian soil. This was the first slightly embarrassing moment in that relationship. But there were points of tension as well, not the least of which was because by July, Curtin as Prime Minister was getting fairly regular hints from General Douglas MacArthur that it wasn't seen by the rest of the world as being totally reasonable that conscripts from countries such as America were being sent to defend Australia. But Australian conscripts themselves weren't being used in that way. The artist Norman Lindsay captured the pressure that Curtin himself was under by foreign allies and even the helplessness of the position that he was in, both in facing the Allied nations as well as facing his own party. There we go. And you can see that in the cartoon here. Curtin, Curtin, the so-called conscientious objector, standing in the conscription court before these severe-faced judges, his greatest allies. And he was powerless. He had no argument to defend the position of his party or of his country. You might know, of course, that by this time in the Second World War, there were two armies. There was the Australian Imperial Force, which was made up entirely of volunteers, and it was this one that was able to be deployed beyond the Australian homeland. And then in addition to that, we had the militia. The Defence Act enabled us to run a militia on the home front for the defence of the civilian population. It was not allowed to be deployed beyond the borders of the country. And so where we had conscripts, they appeared inside the militia itself. And this is where allies such as these protested. Now, under pressure from all sides, from conservative Australia, some argue from the AIF, that's debatable, certainly from our allies themselves, you saw Curtin navigating over the next few months a fairly complicated path of compromise. In November 1942, he faced the National Conference of the Australian Labor Party. He didn't warn many of his colleagues that he was going to take this approach because he knew of the controversy that it would produce. He had lived, of course, through the First World War, clearly. He saw what the conscription debate had done to his own party then. And so, appearing at the conference, which from memory was in Melbourne, he surprised them. He declared that Australia must, should, needed to employ its conscripted recruits beyond the borders of the country itself. His logic was, how could we forcibly send a man to Darwin to resist what? To resist Japanese air raids, and yet not send them to, say, Port Moresby to stop them from getting to Darwin in the first place? Now, predicting severe opposition, he arrived without having warned many people at all, but he provoked a storm in the days which followed. And that storm that followed his declared preference over conscription came from some of his closest colleagues and advisers in his own cabinet. Curtin's proposal was that a compromise. that rather than merging the two armies, as many had suggested, that the militia itself would be sent beyond the strict border of the country and would be sent instead to a region that was considered critical for the defence of the homeland and for the civilian population. So not to Europe, not to the Middle East, but certainly into our own region as the first line of defence of the country. His cabinet colleagues, men like Don Cameron, Arthur Calwell, resisted Curtin's proposal. Arthur Calwell spoke damningly of Curtin's ideas. In classic university lecturing style, I printed off the letter, the speech notes in full as I left tonight and then left them behind on the printer. So I can read with you those notes that are there on the slide. These are notes from Calwell's speech in response to Curtin's proposal about extending the region in which the conscripted militia might serve. And you can see, you might be able to read, you can see here that Call is preparing and denounces him forcefully. "Mr. Curtin," he declares, "has wantonly destroyed the unity of the labour movement. He has done in 1942 what Mr. Hughes, another labour prime minister, in another war period, did in 1916. Mr. Curtin, like Mr. Hughes, has declared for conscription for services overseas for Australia's manhood. Mr. Curtin is, of course, not frank about the matter." He goes on to say something like, without the notes in front, he never uses that hateful expression, conscripted military service. He couches it in softer language. He never talks about being abroad. He talks about instead of being in Australia's region. He doesn't talk about fighting another's war. He talks about defending our own population. And Calwell, his own minister, goes hammer and tongs with Curtin publicly about the proposed amendments.
Where was that speech given?
I believe it was given in Melbourne.
At the Labor Party conference?
Curtin's was, and I don't know about Calwell's. The speech notes come from there, but I don't know whether it was at the same conference. But he wasn't the only one to speak forcefully against the Prime Minister. Eddie Ward did the same thing. Eddie Ward at that time was the Minister for Manpower, so had no small interest in the conscription of forces or the raising of extra numbers. Eddie Ward was another minister, as I mentioned, in Curtin's government. He was the Minister for Manpower. And even though his role was to recruit as many soldiers as possible to fight the conflict, Eddie Ward himself spoke out against Curtin's proposed conscription. And in fact, he was possibly the most damning of all of Curtin's colleagues. He declared that Curtin was putting young men in the slaughterhouse, although 30 years ago you wouldn't go in it yourself. Curtin apparently wept in response in the wake of Ward's comments. How are we to understand comments like those from Calwell, comments from ministers like Ward? How are we to understand those comments without also understanding Curtin's own wartime service from 30 years previously? And indeed, how can we understand Curtin's Second World War at all without understanding his first? Well, historians have commonly used Curtin's First World War experiences, particularly his fight in 1916 against the introduction of conscription, as a way of finding meaning in his experience later as Prime Minister. Manning Clark, for instance, one of the most recognised historians in Australia, liked to use the clash, for example, between Menzies and Curtin as a way of explaining the cultural war that he believed existed then between the old world and the new, or between what Henry Lawson called the old dead tree and the young tree green, between British imperialism and Australian nationalism. John Hurst is another historical colleague of mine, is quick to dispute Clark's interpretation of Curtin and also of the fight Curtin had with Menzies. He notes that, fortunately, Clark's book only finishes in 1935, meaning that he never really had to address the approach that Curtin took himself as Prime Minister to issues such as conscription, to issues like the American alliance, and even to the empire itself and Australia's place within it. And yet, comparisons between Curtin's approach to conscription in 1916 and in 1942 are not perhaps always helpful, The difference between those two periods, those two histories, those two moments in our political history are transparent and they are obvious. Whereas in 1916, the Australian troops of the 1st AIF were fighting a war on behalf of Britain and its empire in countries far from us. By 1942, the 2nd AIF and the militia were fighting a war at home and in our region for the defence of our own country and in response to the casualties of our own civilians. They are two different moments. And perhaps for that reason, a number of historians argue that understanding 1916 is our clue to understanding really how bad things were in 1942. If Curtin himself, of all people, would tolerate the introduction of conscription in 1942, then things must have been grave indeed. But I said recently while visiting scholar at the John Curtin Prime Ministerial Library that on reflection, I think that Curtin's greatest and most enduring legacy from 1916 is not just his experience as wartime Prime Minister. It is also a way of measuring what's happening in Australia now. It is a way of measuring the issues that we face socially, internationally in our foreign policy, politically at home, strategically in our security policies. We can better understand the conditions in which we live today, the politics of modern Australia, the politics of 2016, if we understand the politics that Curtin experienced, the activism that Curtin engaged in 100 years ago in 1916. And that's where I think the greatest legacy, the most enduring meaning, I think, for Curtin and modern Australia can be found. Let me explain to you why. In 1914, when the world experienced the outbreak of that great war, Australians themselves had been by then itching for a fight. The conversation about the prediction, the speculation about the outbreak of a war had been brewing not just for months, but in fact for years. And so by the time the announcement was made, when it was in August in 1914, there was enormous interest, enthusiasm, excitement, sometimes pessimism in the face of that declaration. Journalists at the Argus newspaper in Melbourne talked about the enormous crowds that gathered at the front of the doors, clamouring for news. What's the news? Tell us the news. And in some cases, they argued they saw distress and despair. In most faces, the journalists witnessed excitement, adventure, enthusiasm, patriotism, loyalty. But overwhelmingly, the journalists described a feeling of relief that finally, years of headbutting between these great powers, months of speculation, weeks of edge-of-the-seat politics, we knew now where we were. We knew that this conflict was truly happening. And in the opening months of the war, the state itself capitalised on that degree of enthusiasm. It did so by using the kinds of propaganda that governments today might use, even though the technologies were different. 100 years later, governments might make use of online technologies. They certainly make use of film, of TV, of radio, of posters, of print, of newspapers. Where the same technologies allowed, the government of the day in 1914 and 1915 did the same. They made use of film, of newsreels, of print, of public theatre, of musical recordings. And they used those tools for propaganda to not only enthuse the home front for their engagement with the war, but also to enthuse the recruits themselves, to increase the number of volunteer recruits. And this is one of the things that's quite striking about Australia's history of the First World War. We are, to my knowledge, the only one, and certainly if not one of the only countries, that contributed to the First World War whose army was entirely made up of volunteer recruits. This was something that set us apart from every other country in that conflict. And for that reason, as much as any, the government was absolutely dependent on the public enthusiasm to continue to motivate, to continue to fight that momentum, to find the momentum for ongoing recruits on the home front. I mentioned that one of the tools they used is music. Film was common, theatre was common, newspapers, broadsheets, all of that. But music is one that we often forget. There was a big campaign of patriotic music that was engaged in. There were new compositions, there were stirring military marches that were recorded onto discs. There was the sheet music printed by the thousands in printers in Perth, in Hay Street, Melbourne and other places in Australia, where civilian families were armed with the sheet music with which they could sit down at their piano of an evening and sing along as we dreamt of our soldiers somewhere exciting. One of the ones I like the most, it's not entirely relevant to this one, is It's a Long Way to West Australia. It's a long way to go. It's a long way from West Australia to the sweetest girl I know. Goodbye Midland Junction, farewell Perth so fair, and you can imagine where the rest of it goes, right? That one's charming. And many of them were. Many of them were distressing. They were heart-wrenching ballads that were meant to get you weepy but sympathetic at the same time to the war effort, and in some cases to the losses that the civilian population, that the mothers especially, had sustained. One of the ones I wanted to play for you now, this is assuming that all the sound is going to work, we're hoping it will, is one of the great classics. If England wants a hand, well, here it is. If any of you have recently watched the Mel Gibson, when was it, 1981 movie, Gallipoli, the Peter Weir film, I can say I have recently watched it. I watch it every semester. I can almost read it back word for word. If any of you can remember some of the scenes from that film, this is the song that Mel Gibson and his crew sing while they're barraging through the aisles, through the alleys of Cairo, while they're knocking down shop fronts and while they're disrespecting the British officers that they see in the street and while they pull washing from the line. They're singing, "If England wants a hand, well, here it is." Let's see if we can get the recording playing. I should have mentioned before I played it that it's a crackly recording because it's the original 1915 recording, and you can imagine the technologies in the drum, you know, rather than in the round album that, you know, LP that we're used to now, or once were. This is an interesting item in itself as an indication of the kind of artefacts that exist in our nation's collections. This one and others like them come from the National Film and Sound Archive. Which is extraordinary. We have remarkable records in the JCPML. We have extraordinary records in the National Archives. And each of these documents and artefacts can be used to help tell a story such as this. Another one I want to show you is this one. A letter that comes from memory from the National Archive collection. And it's correspondence from Frank Tudor. You can see here it's in 1915. And he's writing to Jack, his friend Jack Curtin, who he's obviously bumped into at some time recently. And you can read the transcript here, or you may be able to read the transcript here. "I've made some inquiries regarding the book that you spoke to me about the other day," he said. "The importation of that book was prohibited by the desire of the Defence Department whilst the war is on. In connection with the present importation, this has been placed in the King's Warehouse and will be kept there without charge until the end of the war." This is perhaps the first example we have of censorship, as Curtin himself experienced it. What was the book? Well, it was George Kirkpatrick's blistering attack on militarism. "War, What For?" was the title. It sounds a little bit like a song by...
Bruce?
No? Welshman? Really famous? Tom Jones. Good God, war, what's it good for? Yeah? Different war, different era. But it sounds uncannily like a precedent to this. War, what is it good for? War, what for? And Curtin is already, in 1915, reading anti-militant literature. He's already writing anti-militant socialist, sometimes Marxist literatures of his own. And yet, he's still embraced by the Labour Party. In 1914, he ran for the seat of Balaclava in Melbourne, which is where he was then living. And he nearly won it, despite being up against a notable conservative candidate who was the recently resigned Victorian Premier, who had resigned his seat in order to take up the federal seat for Balaclava itself and enter the Australian War Cabinet. That was the mission. That was his intent. And Curtin ran against the Premier on an anti-militant platform and was so successful he pulled the highest Labor vote that seat ever had in the 20th century. And so Curtin, by this time, even in 1915, was recognised by his own party as a voice and a face of the future. And yet he was slipping even then into problems of his own. Alcoholism, depression, there's plenty of evidence in the letters and the correspondence and the records of Curtin from that period that suggests he was struggling at least with both depression and alcoholism. In 1916, in July, he entered rehab. And he was counselled by colleagues in the Labor Party to use the opportunity to sober up, come out clean, and then enter the contest of politics and fight for reform. And that's exactly what he did. And just as he did, things started to get interesting. Billy Hughes, as you know, was then Australia's Prime Minister. He had, at the same time that Curtin himself was in rehab, Billy Hughes was visiting the Australian troops on the front line. And the experience for Hughes was a powerful one. Within days of his departure from France, the AIF's 5th Division was thrown into battle at Fromelles and then at Pozières. In one day alone, the division lost 5,000 casualties. And the scale of that kind of loss was unprecedented. To give you a kind of point of comparison, our entire losses in the Boer War and the South African War was less than 600 troops. So what's that? Nearly 10 times as many were lost in one day alone on the Western Front in France. 3 weeks later, the AIF experienced casualties again of a catastrophic proportion at Pozières. There alone, we suffered 23,000 casualties in the course of 42 days, and that was equal roughly to the total casualties we sustained throughout the entirety of the Gallipoli campaign. The war historian, the official war historian, Charles Bean, later recorded that Pozières is more densely sown with Australian sacrifice than any other place on earth. Now, Hughes returned from having met those troops and received the news by the time he came home that barely any of them had survived the weeks of his own voyage, his return voyage to Australia. And he was haunted by this visit and by the faces that he saw and by the reality of the need of the AIF for reinforcements. But voluntary enlistment alone wasn't keeping up with the numbers. Have a look at this one. An interesting item that comes from the National Archives collection. A confidential secret letter, top secret, sent between Australia's Governor-General in 1916 and the Colonial Office in London. And to London, the then Governor-General reported what our enlistment rates had been like in those few months. In June, the Australian Imperial Force had managed to raise just over 6,000 troops, voluntary troops. About the same, slightly less, the following month in July. In August, until the date that he was writing the letters, which was about 23rd of August, until about two-thirds of the way through August, we'd recruited only 4,000 volunteer recruits. And yet, the casualty rates in just the last 11 days alone had reached nearly 7,000 troops. Enlistments, noted the Prime Minister and the Governor-General, were not enough to replace the numbers of Australians that were falling in the trenches. And so at the end of the month, Hughes gave the country an ultimatum. We had to raise more than 30,000 troops between all of the states. Each state was given a quota that they had to recruit for. And if we didn't do this, if we didn't hit those numbers, if we didn't hit those targets, then he would be compelled to introduce compulsory military service. And faced with uncertain numbers to support him in Parliament, Hughes went over the heads of his parliamentarians and he called for a plebiscite. We often refer to it as the conscription referendum. Because he believed, he declared in fact, that this is the country where the people rule and they will support me, of course. That was his idea. His logic was that even if the Parliament would say no, and he predicted that it would, that the people themselves would say yes. And he predicted that they would. And he got a bit ahead of himself at that point. He called for conscription. He introduced conscription. It's funny, because we talk about there having been no history of conscription in the First World War. Well, the reality is that that Hughes did so. He called up the men, assuming that he was going to win his vote in October. We know he got it wrong. He used, in the meantime, in an attempt to persuade Australians to vote in favour of his conscription referendum, he used the powers of the War Precautions Act and the Defence Act to institute what was a brutal and manipulative and intimidating program of suppression of any of those who would speak against Hughes's agenda for conscription. Within a day of Hughes declaring the necessity for conscription, within a day of him introducing the bill that would start the referendum or the plebiscite process, Hansard itself was already recording arrests that were underway in cities like Melbourne. Arrests of those who were daring enough to speak out against conscription. And yet anti-conscription meetings continued to be held across the country. They were raided, they were violently broken up. In Broken Hill, a meeting of peaceful men and women was raided by 40 armed police. Some of the men were bludgeoned into unconsciousness. Others were bloodied. Women were bludgeoned. Men were taken to hospital and others were imprisoned. And similarly, meetings like this were broken up around the country. In Queensland, the Premier there was forced from his stage after conservative, aggressive soldiers in uniform gate-crashed his Brisbane meeting and shouted down any opposition that they found to conscription. And in the wake of all of this anxiety and this distress on the home front, surveillance and censorship was tightened. In September, Hughes's government, these are extraordinary measures, Hughes's government prohibited civilians to speak in a foreign language while conducting a telephone conversation. And he openly admitted in Parliament that that measure was to enable postal workers to listen in on private conversations to ensure that nothing untoward, that there was no illegal activity, if you like, that was being plotted. Activities, publications, even just conversation that might interfere with recruitment were prohibited. Government censors were given unlimited power to enter a premise that was suspected of printing illegal materials. Newspapers were closely scrutinised before their own publication and strict limits were put onto the material that they could print, either in text or by image. My colleagues in history, Joan Beaumont and Kevin Fuster, have concluded that this kind of censorship was used by the Hughes government in 1916 to muzzle any opposition to conscription and to prohibit the press from reporting stories that were thought to be embarrassing or threatening to the government. This was Hughes's attempt for complete control over the state. Well, this is where Curtin waged his war, his first one. He struggled under the terms of censorship and repression. By this time, Curtin had abandoned his job as the secretary for the Timber Workers' Union, and he was appointed as the organising secretary of the trade union's official no campaign to the conscription vote. And this in itself is interesting. You've heard conversation about that in the last few months. What does Australia do when faced with a plebiscite? Whose voices can be heard? Which voices do we promote and fund? This is a conversation we've had just, what, in the last 6 weeks? You know that in a referendum, there is an official no and an official yes campaign that the state, that the Commonwealth funds. So that the theory being that the population can have an informed opinion when they cast their vote. Well, in 1916, it was unlawful to speak against conscription or the plebiscite itself. There was no official no campaign that was funded by the state. The only no campaign was driven instead by the trade unions and was led on their behalf by John Curtin. And it was, in most of their activity at least, unlawful. And Curtin knew this. He spent, especially the weeks before preceding the vote itself, he spent weeks, nights, sleeping away from home, sleeping around, but not in the way that that sounds now, sleeping at a different house every night, trying to avoid arrest, which he knew was coming. And he complained to Elsie, the woman in Tasmania who he loved and who he'd married by the end of the war. He complained that this was, if you can read his writing, an unfair battle, that we are fighting this battle with our hands tied and our mouths gagged. Every newspaper opposed to us can say what it likes. All the papers on our side are censored out of existence. We cannot get a poster passed by the censors, an article unaltered. So it is a case of desperate remedies. From Monday we will, in addition to the paper activity, circulate vast quantities of leaflets which will not be submitted to the censors. It is a work, he said, of supreme difficulty. There are only four men who know the nature of the leaflets, and only one knows where they are printed. Well, Curtin's own liberty was at risk. He took the evasive action that I mentioned. But it was for more than one reason that the government was keen to arrest John Curtin at this point. It wasn't just his activism against the vote. It was also because he resisted the forced call-up of eligible Australian men. As I mentioned to you before, Hughes did introduce conscription on the Australian home front. It's a story that's not well known, nor its outcome. Assuming that the October vote would be successful, Hughes issued a call-up. You can see even from the newspapers, people openly called this conscription. The soldiers themselves were openly labelled as conscripts. 196,000 men, 196,000, were pulled from their jobs, removed from the economy, taken from their families, and sent to the civilian militia in October 1916. They were issued with unbadged uniforms until what Hughes predicted would be the successful outcome of the referendum when he planned to add the AIF badges to them. And at that point, the plan was these men would be transferred to the AIF and then deployed for overseas service. Now, this also is interesting. After the number of these conscripts, and there were strict rules, I think from memory it was young men aged between, I think, 19 and 40. There were restrictions on it couldn't be somebody with dependents and family, not with children, not with a wife perhaps. So there were some federal members of parliament and judges were excused. So there were some reasons, there were some conditions upon which you could avoid being conscripted in this October call-up. But the Governor-General acknowledged the Plan B, which is in yet another piece of confidential correspondence to London. It's not intended, he writes, until the supply of single men without dependents is exhausted, to apply compulsion to married men, to use under the age of 21 the single men with dependents or to the remaining sons of family in which one or more of the members have already volunteered. It's important to look closely at the words that were chosen by the Governor-General. This point alone demonstrates that the government was prepared to lose, to use and to lose an entire generation of young men. First the 200,000 without wives and children, and then everybody else. Curtin resisted this. He had attempted to enlist earlier in the war, 1914 or 1915, and he was rejected on health grounds on his vision. And yet when he was forcibly called up in October 1916, he refused to turn up. He refused to enlist. And on those grounds also, he was sought for arrest. Now, we know what happens next. We know that he fled to Tasmania, to Elsie, where he wrote to her later, he sought courage by being in her presence to return to Melbourne to the storm and the fire that waited for him there. He was tried in his absence at one point. He was sentenced to something like 6 months imprisonment. I've forgotten the exact number, but I think it's about 6 months. And when he eventually returned to Melbourne, he was arrested and he was sent to jail. Now, by this time, the vote was over. The conscripts had been begrudgingly, some weeks after their call-up, been released, and some weeks after the vote, they were released by the government, and only with pressure. Those that had been imprisoned, and there were something like 7,000 Australian men who were imprisoned for not obeying the call-up call, and they were at this point released also. And yet Curtin was prosecuted and he was imprisoned. And he spent something like 5 or 6 days in jail before his allies in the Labor Party intervened and had the minister quash the conviction, but certainly end the imprisonment. And it was at that point that Curtin came to us. Having been released from jail, he was offered a position here in Perth, and he wrote on the way here, I'll show you the picture. He wrote to Elsie, "I am to win the West for Labour, my love. It is a battle worth having." And this is where he came. And you know the story that followed. You know that, of course, from 1928 he entered Parliament. You know that he spent most of the 1930s in Parliament. You know that from the 1940s he was Prime Minister. And you know the great story of Curtin's Second World War, because that is why we remember him. What we forget to remember, I think, are the conditions that he fought against in 1916 that we see repeated again in 2016. The censorship that Australians experience today. There are a number of examples that may come to mind, both abroad and in Australia. They're not hard to think of. A short list I was putting together earlier this week, I could think of, for instance, the building of that team mentality, that kind of Team Australia image that Abbott used quite extensively while Prime Minister, and more recently Turnbull himself has borrowed from as well when intervening in the dispute between Brandis and the Solicitor General. You've seen in the last few years from both of these governments, you've seen in the last few years that Australians have been urged, it's been insisted upon, that Australians must work for the good of the nation, by which it's commonly meant for the good of the government. You've seen the campaigns that have been waged against the ABC repeatedly in the last 4 or 5 years. You've seen the campaign that's been waged against Gillian Triggs, the Human Rights Commissioner. Some of you may be familiar with the news just today or yesterday that she won't be reappointed next year. The fact that she'd already declared she wouldn't continue is nothing to the spin of today's news, which is that the government won't appoint her. Thank you very much. There are press censorship in place. There are other forms of censorship. Operation Sovereign Borders means that we will never know, we will not know, whether or not and how many vessels arrive in Australia, how many are turned away, what happens to the refugees who are on them. Staff who work at Manus Island and other places like that are prohibited from speaking. The press are prohibited from publishing information from them. So there are experiences of censorship that we have today. There is suppression of information. There is the actions of a state that is protecting its interests. Alison Beveridge, the freelance journalist, wrote recently that unimaginable things can now happen in Australia. Officials can now break the law with immunity. They can act in total secrecy. They will decide what they do, to whom, and to when, and when. They don't have to ask permission. They will choose when to interfere in your life and when they don't. They can dip into your most private communications, and they don't need a warrant to do so. My point is that this is the kind of condition that Curtin himself lived through, that form of censorship, the form of surveillance, the interference with telecommunications and other forms of communication. Australia in 2016 is a lot more like 1916 than we may ever have guessed that we are or that we were. And from my feeling, this is where Curtin's long-term legacy and long-term enduring meaning might be found now for modern Australia. Not just his experience as the wartime Prime Minister from 1941, but also the lessons in activism that we might learn from Curtin in 1916 for a 2016 world. Thank you very much.